Hello, and welcome to another edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews, a fan-requested review. Today's video game based on a movie that we'll be reviewing is Demolition Man, published by Acclaim Entertainment in 1995 for the Super Nintendo, Sega Genesis, and Sega CD. Demolition Man is a 1993 science fiction, big star-filled movie that used special effects, futuristic settings, and statements on society to make for a silly but fun production overall. The movie was released by Warner Brothers Studios and directed by Marco Brambilla. The movie was not the huge success the studio hoped for in the box office, as it only raked in a little over $58 million in the North American market, and the critics and fans had mixed feelings on the film. The movie got prime treatment, though, with the toy line, comic book adaptation, and of course, movie-based games. It also got big-name Hollywood stars in the leading and supporting roles. The main focal character of the story, police officer who delivers his own brand of justice to the bad guys, Sergeant John Spartan, is portrayed by Sylvester Stallone. The main foil of the movie, sadistic and psychopathic villain Simon Phoenix, is portrayed by Wesley Snipes. And no story is complete without a female interest, and in this movie it's Lieutenant Liana Huxley, portrayed by another well-known actress, Sandra Bullock. Rounding out the rest of the cast is Nigel Hawthorne as the spiritual leader of San Angeles, Dr. Raymond Cocteau. Dennis Leary as head of the underground dwelling scraps, Edgar Friendly. And Rob Schneider as police officer Irwin. The movie focuses on two time periods. We start out in 1996. Simon Phoenix is a crime lord and psychopath who has kidnapped a bus full of people. Enter Sergeant John Spartan, a cop known as the Demolition Man, as he leaves everything destroyed in his path to take down the criminals. And he tries to take down Phoenix as only he can. Phoenix sets off explosives, destroying the building and killing all of its hostages. Phoenix and Spartan do make it out of the exploding building in time, but both are sentenced to be cryo-frozen. Fast forward to the year 2032. The city is now a huge megalopolis known as San Angeles. Crime has been all but eliminated. It is now a happy utopia. It is thanks to the leadership of Raymond Cocteau, who everyone respects and follows. This will all change as parole hearing for Simon Phoenix is about to be held. During his hearing, he escapes from his confines and kills the warden. The police, who aren't used to dealing with a real criminal such as him, are sent to apprehend him, and Simon Phoenix is able to easily beat all of them without even trying. Dr. Cocteau tells the police commissioner to do whatever it takes to stop him. He takes that literally and unfreezes the man that stopped him in the first place, Sergeant John Spartan. To help him acclimate better into the new timeline he finds himself in, he is assigned to partner with Lieutenant Liana Huxley. And let's just say the situation unfolds from here, with Phoenix trying to find more powerful weapons and take over the society he now finds himself in, and Spartan showing up each time to try and stop him. They go from location to location all throughout the city in a typical action movie type of exchange of insults and shootouts, with some jokes thrown in for good measure. We also learn that everyone is not as happy in this utopian society as we would believe. A typical action-packed movie with big explosions and moments is what you expect from a movie made in the 90s. This could be a fun game if it can capture the action and situations from the film properly. And that's what we'll look at now as we take a peek at the other version of games made based off of this film. Let's see how it goes this time. On to the review. There were two versions of games made based off of this movie. This particular version, by Acclaim Entertainment, was ported to three consoles on the market at the time. The Super Nintendo and Genesis versions, both released as game cartridges, and the Sega CD version, released on CD media, and it adds a few extras like movie-based video footage that shows up before some of the stage starts, and a rockin' soundtrack as background stage music. Either way, all three versions are identical, so with that being the case, we'll review the game as a whole and note differences found in the Sega CD version as applicable. In this game, you'll once again play as the movie's main hero, John Spartan, as you venture through 10 stages in total, with most of the stages being traditional platform-based stages, whereas two of the stages will be top-down view perspective stages. Loading up the game on any of the versions gets you a title screen where you can start a new game, tweak the options, and do something called actions that will allow you to view possible moves you can perform in the game itself prior to playing it. Starting out the adventure will differ on the cartridge-based versus disc-based versions. On the SNES and Genesis cartridges, it will give you a simple bit of text saying Los Angeles, 1996. As the game just starts with our would-be hero jumping out of a copter into action, using the graphics of the cartridge-based system to show this. On the Sega CD version, we get video clip moments showing the exact opening moments of the film, and setting up the moments to reuse of that before it'll start the game outright. Besides these little video additions, the games play exactly the same once you start playing them. The first stage does indeed take place in the opening moments of the film in present-day Los Angeles, and you're now venturing through an area trying to work your way to Simon Phoenix, who's waiting at the end for your arrival. Unlike the movie, you're now racing across rooftops of dilapidated buildings and crime-filled areas as you blast and shoot every enemy you approach to remove them so you can progress further. Besides your gun that you can upgrade, you can also collect bombs that you can throw at enemies to remove them as well. It's pretty basic and to the point. As expected, the first stage is a stage to get you used to how most of the game will play out by giving a taste of some of the things you'll be expected to deal with as the game progresses. As you reach the end of the stage, in what was a very simplistic venture from start to finish, you approach Simon Phoenix, who is waiting there at the bottom, and like in the movie, he'll set off bombs taking down the open building as you chase him out of it. The moments that follow will again differ in the cartridge and disc-based versions of this game. In the cartridge-based versions, you are given text showing that you are now in the future in San Angeles 2032. You'll go to a score tally after this before you can progress further in the game. The Sega CD version tries to show off what it can do that shows all the footage leading up to entering the future that the movie takes place in. It's all edited nicely and spells out the situation quite well. You are then, like in the cartridge version, taken to a score tally screen. The only real difference in the cartridge and disc-based version of the same game is that they added a lot of movie clips in between some of the stages, which I suppose in the mid-1990s was cool to see in a game. The on-screen displays for this game are actually quite simplistic. The bottom left of the screen is where the displays will focus for this game. And the first display is a projectile display. And this will show which projectile, if any, you currently have in the inventory at the time. And there are three. Yes, only three different projectile-based weapons that you can pick up during the game's run. You can get grenades, which are standard bombs that you can toss in front of you, and upon explosion, it will take out anything near it. You can also get napalm bombs, which are fire grenades, and they will set an area on fire where it lands, and for a very short period of time, anything that comes near it will take damage. And then the last stage of the game, you get cryo grenades, which will cause anything it hits to freeze for a very short period of time. Below this is a red horizontal bar that is your life meter. And as you take damage from enemies or obstacles, the bar will get shorter from right to left. When you lose all your energy, the bar is empty and you lose a life and will start back not too far away from where you last were. You can replenish your life energy by picking up first aid kits that are found similarly to the bombs all throughout the stages. There are also hidden displays that will show up as applicable before fading away again after they do show up. The top left is a gun display, and this will show you how powerful your quit pistol is at the moment. You start out with a standard unlimited ammo rapid firing pistol that is of average strength and will have to hit enemies a few times to take them down for good. As you pick up gun items that you find on stages, you upgrade your gun. Every time you do so, this display shows up to give you a picture of what your upgraded weapon now looks like. Sadly, the upgrades are only short-lived and have an untold amount of shots in them before reverting back to the standard gun. On the bottom center of the screen is a Demolition Man icon display that'll show up sometimes, and this is your extra life display. When you pick up the item that matches the look of said display, you get an extra life. These extra lives are scattered throughout the stages and often in harder to reach places, but more than enough to really stack them up if you can avoid getting killed too often. So displays in this game are very simple. You don't even realize you have a score until the end of the stage. Besides your own life meter, everything else is kept away when not needed. I actually liked how they did it here, believe it or not. Simple and to the point, and useful enough to give you the info needed. So, well done there. Most of the game is really just blasting away enemies of various types on every single stage of the game, which itself makes no sense in context to the movie, as that is definitely not what is being done in most moments of the film. And that's where this game is hurt a bit by the connection, as it comes off more as a generic shooter than a true rendition of the movie and its universe. And what type of enemies are we fighting in these stages? Well, they are similar looking generic grunt thugs with no real distinguishing features to note of. Some will be lightly armed or show up with stronger weapons, but that's really the only difference to note of. And it never really changes much in any of the platform-based stages. I suppose some of the criminals were related to Phoenix's gang, and some are related to Friendly's gang that are found under the sewers. But they all act exactly the same no matter who they were. They'll hang from ladders and shoot down at you, or guard areas you are venturing towards, or even appear hidden or behind barriers. But it's the same exact look to everything, enemy-wise, in the entire game, which I guess doesn't matter, as again, there were no real enemy types to note of in the movie anyway. Unlike the 3DO version, which had 4 stage variants, the Acclaim Entertainment version of the game has 2 stage variants, and the platforming moments make up the bulk of gameplay. Platform moments will try to mix things up a bit and add some variety and differences here and there to keep it interesting and fresh. Since most of the stages are the platforming variety, we'll focus on that aspect of the game first. And these type of stages are your typical console type based fare here, where you're the main character and you're going around shooting every enemy you come near as you try to blast them away so you can continue on. The stages will offer some other options besides just moving right or left on each part of the stage, or up and down on ladders, which of course would get old and repetitive very quickly. There are bungee jumping moments, which will become a fun deviation at points, where you reach a special location of the stage, and are suddenly jumping off a rope of a high point down a long pit. They also add infrared moments, where you have to pick up goggles to see in the dark. Some of the stages will become pitch black suddenly, and the only way to see them is through these infrared goggles. Some levels will have hatches to go through and give other areas to navigate through. There's a weird variation stage that takes place in an automated parking garage that has the parking device targeting you all the while, and you have to jump out of its way at various points before taking it on at the end of the level as a boss. And the most fun would be the zip line moments, where you speed down long lines shooting at everything and avoiding enemies in your path as you jump from line to line. So it wasn't just straight through platforming side-scrolling found on these stages. And to the game's credit, it does try and add a bit of variety in what can be a very standard been there done that game otherwise. The other two stages found in this game are top-down perspective, and you're venturing through buildings having to work your way from the starting point to an end point as you open up passageways by rescuing a civilian, who will always say,
"Be well,"
as you touch them. All the while, you continue to shoot enemies and collect weapons and healing items similarly to the other stage type. So it's a bit of a puzzle in that you have to find the right person to rescue to open up locked areas, with the enemies put in strategic locations and seem to keep respawning at some points as you have to clear out a dozen or so at a time, making it more like a Smash TV game over a Demolition Man game. Things get even harder when they start to throw in wall-mounted lasers that follow you about and are hard to destroy, along with the enemies you still have to deal with all the while. The lasers are the hardest aspect of these top-down stages, as you have to decide if you want to just try to outrun their shots and move in a pattern around said beam so they can't get to you, or if you want to take the time to carefully remove each laser so that they won't be a problem. Luckily, the stages aren't timed, so you can take your time to get through them as you like, but it can get tedious trying to remove each one, so you may decide to just try to avoid them altogether. I always found it interesting that games with powerful movie-based cops always come down to how many people can you kill as you pursue one single enemy. But those are the two stage types, and they each offer something a bit different, with the platformers at least mixing it up a bit to add some more excitement to things, and the top-down moments being a shoot-em-up exploration mix that works well enough for what it was. Strangely enough, there is no driving stage. What they do provide is some areas that were not found in the film and make for a strange deviation on things. The first moments taking place, as expected, in the present day of the movie, Los Angeles 1996. Then the next stages to follow will take us right to the future in 2032 in San Angeles, where you'll explore a museum both inside of it in top view perspective, with the next stage being the underground museum in platforming style. We get the before-mentioned automated garage area that wasn't in the film, followed by another original to this game stage that takes place on a monorail, with a third unrelated stage taking place in a library, then the underground areas as seen in the movie, which will have you sliding down zip lines, followed by a stage with huge sewer pipes before your final assault on the cryo prison, for the final stage and confrontation with Simon Phoenix. So it's all here, sorta kinda, but it shows how limiting the story is of the movie, with the lack of any real vital locations to go to, having to resort to coming up with a few original areas and stretching out some for all they're worth. There are a few vocals here and there, with it sounding much better on the Sega CD version over the cartridge-based ones, but there's nothing really different added to either version, so the same sound clips are used in both, with Spartan using his line from the movie,
"Send the maniac to catch
him. Heads up!"
and the computer voice repeating the phrase,
"MDK,"
after you complete a level. Nothing too much, but that's more due to the limitation of the media these were originally made for than the lack of trying. This probably would have connected better to the movie if they were able to get more nods to the movie with something involving the morality violation devices or fast food restaurants. The graphics are okay, really. There's nothing that impressive, and the system this is found on can do a much better job than is done here. The backgrounds have some life and color to them, trying to fit into the moments properly, but the game is very dark and lacking for the most part. Single color is used too often, and even the future is depressing and dreary feeling. Nothing looks terrible, and you can tell who is who in 16-bit renditions of all the characters. The Sega CD does improve things graphically with the use of actual movie clips inserted in between some of the stage starts, and the stages look a bit sharper and cleaner on this format. This game is average and basic graphics at best. Controls worked well enough to not offer too much difficulty in playing it. It's a basic run-and-gun type of game where you're shooting everything in sight with the push of a button on the controller, with another button firing your grenade-type weapons you collect, and another button to jump. You move about using the D-pad where you can duck by pushing down and move left and right accordingly, and up to go up on ladders. Latching onto items was hit or miss at times, which seems to be the case in many games I play though, but nothing overly frustrating. There's even a roll move which you won't use often but works well when you need it, like in a later stage with the sewers where you have flames that you have to roll through to avoid them. So I have to say the controls were fine here, which was important due to how many thugs you find yourself shooting at as you're jumping and moving about all at once. There are some boss moments that will show up at the end of some of the stages here. Each time you're in a boss confrontation, the boss's energy meter will show up on the bottom or top of the screen, mirroring the look of your own health meter. The first confrontation in the game is the second stage, being against Simon Phoenix. If you venture through the Top View Museum, you have to fight him one-on-one as he will run back and forth using a new super weapon that he found, and you have to shoot him in between his own blast as he moves from the top position to the bottom position of the stage, and then vice versa, while other enemies can show up behind you all the while. A basic whittle his energy down type of situation as you avoid his counterattacks. You can continue the fight with him at the end of the next stage, where he's on a platform above firing at you, and you have to deal with his powerful weapon blast and other enemies attacking all the while. And as he escapes, you have to climb up onto the platform and chase after him. Again, nothing too complicated. The first real difficult boss fight comes in the car garage stage, where you have to fight the automated car gripping claw that has been chasing you the whole stage. As you confront it, you have to avoid a car that it's trying to drop on you as you shoot up as it's lowering back down to get another car. It will throw in some lightning-based attacks here and there that will sweep along the floor that you'll have to try to run past and avoid. Again, while also throwing in regular thugs that are attacking you as you're taking on this boss. So it's a long fight as you have to just keep on whittling down its energy and repeating the pattern over and over again. Keep doing so and it'll eventually explode and be taken offline for good. And that's really the only boss confrontations besides the ending battle in the game, which we'll get to shortly. Most of the stages in the game will just end as you reach the endpoint without a boss confrontation. But at least they did add some boss fight elements to the mix, and they worked well enough for what they were. Again, the movie's lacking plot in getting many fight moments is the problem that both versions of the game had to work with, with this game making up a whole stage and boss fights to stretch things out even further. The game will be about an hour or so long, a little longer if you have trouble in some spots, but you can get through it in that amount of time. The last stage of the game takes place in the cryo prison, as the movie did, and you're on your final hunt to get Phoenix before he releases all the criminals that are frozen there. It's a basic platform stage as the earlier ones were, but you do get a new item to use here as projectile, that being the cryo bomb. This will freeze any enemy that it makes contact with. Most of the stage itself, though, is just going from level to level of the building to work your way down to the bottom floor. On the bottom floor, you'll see Phoenix standing above, but he's not your first target. The mechanical arm, as again seen in the movie, is your first boss fight. Phoenix will try to use it to grab and squeeze the life out of you. Your objective? Freeze the arm with the cryo grenades and blast away as it's frozen. If you're taking some energy off the frozen claw, it will lose its arms and become a press that tries to squish our hero flat. Keep freezing it and blasting away the frozen arm, and repeat until it's finally disabled and will bounce away. Now the last fight of the game is against Simon Phoenix, who waits above with the cryo weapon trying to freeze you. Simon will jump back and forth on the above platforms, and then fill the floor with ice. You have to keep on avoiding the ice, and when you have an opening, fire an ice grenade back at him and return the favor. When he's frozen, you can now blast away at him and take off energy. It's only a short period of time that you have to do so you have to act very fast. It's actually a very tricky battle that takes good timing and controls to get just right. You'll miss hitting him with grenades often, and he will unfreeze before you had a chance to fire back at him many times. And as he freezes you, he laughs with delight. If you run out of cryo grenades, you have to wait for more to appear after you shoot at Simon, who's jumping above you. If you can freeze him enough and fire at him while he's frozen, you will finally finish him off, ending his evil reign forever. The ending will vary a bit in the cartridge and CD-based version of the game. In the SNES and Genesis version, the game will end after you see Phoenix explode into ice cubes as the building explodes. They show a weird drawn picture of Spartan jumping out just in time before it takes you to a final score tally screen. You see a screen capture of Spartan holding his gun up as it says in text that you're truly a Demolition Man before it goes to the end credits. In the Sega CD version of the game, you get the same in-game ending of the building exploding as you flee, but instead of the weird picture, you'll get real-time movie moments showing the final moments of the film, with Spartan finally disposing of Phoenix. After that long recap of the movie's final moments will end, you get to the final score tally screen. So pretty much the CD version just adds some movie footage and not much more. And that's the end of that game. Well, it was okay. That moment matches, at least. The Sega CD music matches music-wise due to the use of accurate and unedited cutscenes ripped from the movie itself. That is perhaps the only place it truly matches to the movie soundtrack. It's hard to tell how accurate the music played in the background of the stages is, but it all sounds fine either way and feels like it belongs. One thing the game does do right is that it's well-implemented music on both versions. While most of the music found here seems like it's not from the soundtrack, it still sounds proper and fits the moments you'll find yourself in. It sounds even better with a new and remixed soundtrack for the Sega CD version, which really shows off what the system was capable of, sound-wise at least. So I had no problem with the music here, as the CD version uses real movie moments without changing the background themes of said clips, and the soundtrack to the movie is not really a memorable one that it would matter if you used it exactly or otherwise as background stage music. I'm sure very few would even know listening to this that it's not from the movie. And it's just a plus that the music actually happens to be not too bad. So that worked fine for me. The game is a basic shooter where you as the main hero just shoot everything in your path and try to get through stages. That isn't a bad thing, and for a 16-bit system-based game, it worked well, as that is what is found on said system at the time in many cases. Pulls off the controls, situations, and look well enough. You get some variation through top-down perspective stages that are added to the mix, and a weapon variety to use in both gun and grenade choices. It's a solid shooter as far as that goes, with the game not being overly difficult, but frustrating at points. The game's connection to the film is where it lacks a bit. John Spartan has gone from being on a one-man mission to stop Simon Phoenix, from spreading fear and terror through San Angeles, to in the game being a one-man killing machine trying to rack up high murder-death kill totals and doing a lot more harm than the guy you were pursuing could ever cause. A lot of moments are overlooked, like the vehicle chase scene from the movie, and some of the locations don't make sense to be going to. Good movie-based games have good games that are fun, but also at least relate to the source material. This one has moments here and there where it does relate with the use of voice clips, and the boss moments with Phoenix seeming to match very well. But the overall game seems to be a basic platform shooter, with the story squeezed in somehow where it could be. Graphically, while the game looks okay and detailed, the stages are way too dark and dreary, or just single-colored filled, as is the case with the top-down perspective stages. I understand they were going for a certain style here, but it makes it hard to see what's going on when you have just one color at times, or very dark backgrounds that you're in. While I would love to say that playing this on the Sega CD gives a much better and enhanced version of the game, as was the case for Batman Returns on Sega CD, sadly, that's not the case here. Besides the inclusion of very long cutscenes ripped from the movie, and a nice soundtrack being used as background music, it's essentially the same exact average no-frills Sega Genesis version of the game, and doesn't really need to be on a CD, unless you like some movie clips and better sounding music as you play the same average hour-long game. Well, there isn't much more to say here. You go through various stages, shoot everyone in sight, play with some toys, climb some ladders, take on some bosses, and it's not too difficult all the while, but not something that most will be running back to often either. Pretty much just another average, enough was done to make it playable game, and you get the gist of the movie here and there as you take down some thugs as John Spartan. And this concludes our look into games based off of Demolition Man. As is the case all too often, nothing great found here on either version, but to all those big fans of the movie at the time it was out, they have something more to enjoy, but it's not something they would be going back to often as stated previously. So, with that all said, we are going to give this game the MDK inducing overall score tally of That's all for this edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Please be sure to check back soon for our next video game based on a movie review.